Right now, he's busy rushing to confirm right-wing judges. His crony from Kentucky stands against everything that we need in America. At a time when we need unity, McConnell's pushing a judge to the second highest court in the land who thwarts voting rights, who thwarts civil rights, who thwarts the very things we need. And he's doing everything he can, McConnell is, so Donald Trump doesn't fire off a mean tweet in his direction. At their press conference, McConnell said, "We'll take a look at criminal justice reform." He said he would take a look right after there were shootings at doing something about background checks, and he never did. We hope his take a look is not duck, but we're afraid past experience shows that it is. But we're going to keep pushing him and pushing him, because we cannot allow the immediate needs of the American people to wait for Senator McConnell and Senate Republicans to act. A divided nation cannot wait for healing, for solutions. And we cannot stay silent and not answer. We must answer the president for what he did last night. And that's why in about an hour and a half, we will be putting on the floor a unanimous consent resolution condemning the president's actions that has the support of every single member of our Democratic caucus. This resolution condemns the president for what he did. I know that the overwhelming majority of Americans will agree with us. The resolution says that the constitutional rights of Americans to peaceably assemble, exercise freedom of speech, and petition the government for redress of grievances must be respected. That violence and looting are unlawful, unacceptable, and contrary to the purpose of peaceful protest. And that the Congress condemns the President of the United States for ordering federal officers to use gas and rubber bullets against Americans who were peacefully protesting in Lafayette Square in Washington, D.C. on the night of June 1st, thereby violating constitutional rights of those peaceful protesters. We will not allow the president to take away the First Amendment rights of Americans. Senate Republicans should stand with us, stand with the American people, stand with the Constitution, stand with unifying us, not dividing us. They should support our resolution. I say to Senate Republicans, stop being afraid of what President Trump might tweet about you and support the resolution. Senator Booker.
Thank you. I'm grateful for Leader Schumer and my colleagues. This is a time of great pain and a great frustration in the United States of America, people all over our country.
I'll be right back. I didn't vote. I forgot.
Thank you, Senator Schumer.
The sausage gets made.
It's how the sausage gets made. It really is. I think a lot of Americans, most Americans, feel horrified and outraged by the brokenness of our criminal justice system. And to watch a police officer murder someone on live TV sitting on their neck, knee on the neck for 8 minutes and 46 seconds, but this happened also in the context of Ahmaud Arbery, murdered while jogging through his community. It happens in the context of Breonna Taylor, murdered while sleeping in her own home by police unannounced, barged in and began that confrontation. It's in the context of other incidences like we saw in Central Park, or someone threatens to call the police on an African-American man. For so many Americans, this is not a tough week or a tough few weeks. This is the story of life every single day. And we have so many people in our country, African-American men mostly unarmed, being murdered by police officers and no way of holding them accountable. And so the challenge we face in this body is, what are we going to do? Because that is the question that protesters are demanding. What will change? Will we be a society that is racked and spasmed by protest and demonstration every so often when videotape captures what is a regular part of our culture and our nation and splays it out on national TV that enrages a population, understandably so, where there are protests? And so I'm proud to be a part of a caucus that is offering a way forward. Senator Harris and I have partnered to lead our caucus in a larger, comprehensive piece of legislation, which takes into the work of our Congressional Black Caucus, which has been working on these issues for many, many years, if not decades. It takes into incorporation so many of the ideas from our colleagues and puts forth a larger vision. She and I, will, other Senate colleagues, will be unveiling that in the days to come. But this has got to be a time where we understand that the work still demands. We are a nation that, as one of our great historians and great figures, W.B. Du Bois, said, that the problem of the 20th century is the problem of the color line. Well, here we are in the early stages of the 21st century, and we did not solve that problem in the last one. That color line now divides what kind of educational outcomes you will have for too many Americans. It divides between what kind of environment, air you will breathe, with environmental justice still being determined by race. It divides what kind of health care you may receive, the economy you may enjoy, the criminal justice system you will encounter. And like far greater leaders who martyred themselves to change that reality, to make this a nation with equal justice under the law, with liberty and justice for all, of all backgrounds, from those heroes like Goodman, Cheney, and Schwerner, Black, white, Christian, Jewish, joining together to fight to erase that savage line in our nation, we still have work to do. And that means that we must, like those civil rights marchers who gathered here in this city demanding legislative changing, demanding federal change, like the 1964 Civil Rights Act, the 1965 Voting Rights Act, the 1968 Fair Housing Act. Those were to do the work of racial justice and equality in our country. Well, we now must act on policing. I want to finally say, because we are indeed calling unanimous consent on the issue of what happened yesterday, and I have to simply say I grew up understanding the debt I owe to this city. I was born in Washington, D.C. Two Black parents who came from historically Black colleges, and this was the city of opportunity. They met here, they married here, and it was activists, Black and white, in this city that got companies to hire Blacks for the first time. Because of activists in Washington, D.C., my father became the first Black person hired by IBM as a salesman in this region, and I'm going to add to that, that this was a tumultuous time. It was the 1960s, and in this city, we had peaceful gatherings, perhaps the greatest of all time. My mom was working in DC public schools and took the summer to help organize the March on Washington. I'm here because of those marches. I'm here because of those protests. And last night, I felt a sense of embarrassment because I can't pay them back. I got to pay it forward. And my embarrassment came is that I wasn't there in that park, because I can imagine what would have happened in America if a president during the greatest march of that era, the March on Washington, had decided that they wanted to parade in the public for a photo op, and upon those peaceful assembled protesters on the Washington Mall to hear one of the greatest speeches of all times, what would have happened if they came out upon those peaceful gatherers with tear gas, rubber bullets, horses marching against those protesters? I'm embarrassed that I was 2 miles from that park and I did not get there to stand with those protesters. Well, I'll tell you what, Donald Trump, every member of this co-equal body should condemn what this president did, trampling upon the most sacred right of this nation to assemble, to petition, to protest. What this president did was to make a mockery of our civil rights. I say ours. I was not there in that park, but every one of us should wish we were there. And I'm telling you right now, if Donald Trump wants to gas someone next time, start right here. If he wants to shoot somebody with our federal officials with rubber bullets, start right here. If he wants to trample them with horses while they peacefully assemble, come to this body. Because what he did to those Americans in that square yesterday, he did to all of us. Shame on him to stand and hold up the Bible of our faith, of a man who understood humility, our Savior, who stood up against power misuse, who stood up against every instinct that he showed yesterday. And so today, the least we can do as a body is not to remain silent. That is shame. But to speak out against it. This was a moment yesterday on this sacred ground, our Capitol, where people protesting on issues from women's rights to civil rights to LGBTQ rights, people on the left and the right of the spectrum come to understand that if you stand peacefully, if you protest peacefully, you will be respected by your federal government, and that was violated yesterday. And so where do you stand today? Well, 100 members of this body will be tested about where they stand. That is a gently written unanimous consent. Everyone should stand up and be counted right now and say aye.
Thank you, Corey. Amazing. Senator Harris.
My sister. My brother. Well, Senator Booker said it. In the last couple of days, I've been saying America is raw right now. Her wounds are exposed. The reality of it is that the life of a black person in America, historically and even most recently with Mr. Floyd, has never been treated as fully human. And it is time that we come to terms with the fact that America has never fully addressed the systemic racism that has existed in our country. That's just a fact. And so the people protesting on the street are protesting, understanding that we have yet to fulfill that promise of equal justice under the law. And there is a pain that is present, that is being expressed in their constitutional right to march and to shout. Like Senator Booker, I am a child of parents who marched and shouted in the civil rights movement in the 1960s. I would not be here as only the second black woman elected to the United States Senate were it not for those folks who marched and shouted for justice. I would literally not be here were it not for those folks who took to the streets. My parents had their stories of how the police were turned on the marchers, but they still marched. And it was their march that laid the path for me to be here today, to speak at this moment, and to speak to this moment. And as a former prosecutor, a profession I chose because I also, growing up, the way I did, knew how law enforcement had a long history of enforcing laws indiscriminately and often based on race and racism. That's why I chose to become a prosecutor. And I can say with full certainty that it is time that the leaders in this United States Senate, in this United States Congress, take action to reform a criminal justice system that for far too long has been informed by systemic racism and by racial bias. It is time that we say that bad cops are bad for good cops. It is time that we say that one should not be subjected to the indignity of being told to get on your knees and put your hands behind your head simply because you are walking while black. And it happens every day in America. There's not a black man I know, be he a relative, a friend, or a coworker or colleague, who has not been the subject of some form of racial discrimination at the hands of law enforcement. Not one I know. And I am talking about people at every level of life, including people who graduated Harvard and Stanford and you name it. And the only thing that is common among them is that the color of their skin is black. That's why the people are marching in the streets. And the reality is that racism in America is bad for everyone. Racism is bad for everyone. Racism against black folks and Latinos and Asians and our Native brothers and sisters, it's bad for everyone. So this is a moment in time where we have to address this. And we have to address it, sadly, in the context of a pandemic that has also laid bare longstanding disparities in our public health system, in our education system, in our economy based on race. This is happening at a moment in time where we have a so-called commander-in-chief who also has the title of President of the United States, who I promise you will never speak the words Black Lives Matter. Well, they do. So this is a moment in time where this co-equal branch of government has a responsibility to stand for the principles of those words that are etched in that marble building across the street, equal justice under law. And to do it in a number of ways, understanding that the policing issue is the tip of the iceberg. It is underneath it, is also these issues of longstanding racial disparities based on housing, based on education, based on public health. But right now, this is the moment in time to address the issue of policing. And so the package of bills that Senator Booker and I and so many of our colleagues are pulling together is specifically to address that, because it must be addressed. It is a pervasive issue. And it's 30 years after Rodney King. And the chants and the marches and the songs are about the same issue that we were marching for back when my parents did in the 60s and when we did after Rodney King 30 years ago. So now is the time to act. Leader Schumer, I thank you for your leadership of our caucus and your leadership as a great American leader on an issue that has too long plagued us and that we have the power to address. Thank you.
I hold the Senate seat that was once occupied by the first African-American woman elected to the United States Senate. My Senate seat is also the one held by the senator who eventually became the first black president of these United States. About 4 years ago, I began writing a piece of legislation during the Laquan McDonald incident on police reform. And I did it with the help of Lori Lightfoot, who is now the city of Chicago's mayor. And I'm so proud that Kamala Harris was an original co-sponsor 4 years ago and remains on this bill. And every other female senator of color is also a co-sponsor of this piece of legislation. We have so far a number of people on it. I'm so proud that when I started the Environmental Justice Caucus, Cory Booker became my co-chair. These issues are exactly that. They're more than about policing. It's about the systematic bias that exists in our country at all levels. When I watched on TV, when I saw George Floyd say, "I can't breathe," and then when he called up Mama, it destroyed me because I was with my two daughters at the time. As a mom, you have no idea what that did to see someone crying, choking, pleading for their life underneath the knee of someone who was sworn to protect and serve. And that with his last dying breath, Mr. Floyd called out for his mom, who had died 2 years before. I am here as a woman of color, not as a black woman, but as a woman of color, but more importantly, as an ally. Because I know that I have the privilege that I will never have to sit down with my two little girls and teach them how to de-escalate conflict with law enforcement. Instead, I teach my girls, if you are in trouble, run for someone in uniform. Ask them for help. That is sanctuary. That is a safe place. But that is not the case for so many in our black and brown communities. And that is un-American. And then last night, I watched as President Trump, having gassed peaceful protesters just so he could do this photo op, then he went on to tear gas priests who were helping protesters in Lafayette Park, and then he went on to remove a member of the clergy and a layman from the church patio so he could have his photo op. And as he was walking there, he was followed behind him by the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff in military fatigues and the Secretary of Defense, walking along like lap dogs behind a draft-dodging wannabe tin pot dictator. And I was appalled that this commander-in-chief was flying Black Hawk helicopters above Americans exercising their First Amendment rights. How dare you politicize our military? Our military is the most diverse institution in this country. Our military is one of the final places where Americans have nothing but greatest respect. How dare you pervert the honor of our military by threatening to use them against their fellow Americans? I am sickened to the core by this man. And so I am so proud that my little piece of legislation will be incorporated, some parts of it will be incorporated into the larger legislation. But I am here to call on American voices. If you truly believe in the values of this country, in justice and in liberty, then you know that we need to reform policing at all levels. And I am asking black and brown voices to come forward in every neighborhood. I'm also asking all of us to come forward as allies. We need Republicans and all decent Americans to join us in our outrage and our disgust for this injustice. We need Mitch McConnell to stop sitting on his hands, and he needs to roll up his sleeves and get to work. Work with us to make this nation more just, more equal for all who live here, regardless of the color of their skin. George Floyd cannot breathe anymore. So it is on the rest of us who are lucky enough to be able to still take our breath, to use our voices, to speak with every breath that we take from now on to fight against injustice and fight for the justice that he was robbed on that street in Minneapolis last week. Thank you.
Well, I want to thank my three colleagues for their beautiful, heartfelt words that I hope pierce the hearts of some of our Republican colleagues.
Police accountability legislation because they feared that it wouldn't go over well with some of their law and order voters. Do you sense that there is a shift now and that the party would be united?
On our call today, there was from people of every different political persuasion and geography voiced a deep concern that we do something strong and real.
And then on the president, after the events of last night, a number of your Democratic colleagues described the president as an autocrat. a tyrant, Senator
dictator
Senator Harris.
She said it right. Would be tin pot dictator. He will take his power as far as he can get away with, even if it undoes large parts of our democracy. That's what I believe about him.
So do you believe that the nation is headed towards a dictatorship?
Look, we have checks and balances. We have us. But we're asking all Americans of every political persuasion, race, creed, color, and party to fight his abuse of power, his taking away the rights of citizens. And if past is prologue, he will fail, but only if we stand up.
On that point, about the strong words you've used against this president and names you've used, dictator, et cetera, is that productive? Are you just stooping to his level?
You gotta call it for what it is. We're not, he just gratuitously attacks people with no basis in fact. We're responding to one of the most horrible displays of presidential overreach, of presidential deprivation of power, of presidential un-Americanism that there is. It requires strong language.
What's your sense of timing on a broader legislative package? When can we expect to see
Well,
that?
I know that Corey and Kamala and Tammy and the others who are working on it, and we're all working together as a caucus, which is great, want to move fairly quickly. And I've called on McConnell to bring something to the legislature, bring something to the Senate floor on criminal justice in June.
What do you think needs to be done with the looting that's happening? Should the National Guard be utilized?
Well, look, we condemn the violence everywhere, but there wasn't violence in Lafayette Square Park.
What about elsewhere around the country that New
well,
York
again,
night, for example,
again, we have every one of us has condemned the violence wherever it occurs. But we want to make sure that the enforcement against that violence is equal. There are 5,000 people who were arrested for violence in the demonstrations. There are 4 police officers who were involved in the murder of Floyd. Only one has been arrested. That's the unequal enforcement of the law that is bothering so many people in a very real way. Last question.
Commissioner, on the next round of coronavirus relief legislation, a number of your Republican Senate colleagues say that they don't think another round of $1,200 rebate checks is a good use of money. It should be a lower priority. What do you think about that?
I think we need a big, strong, bold bill. I support COVID for, you know, the CARES bill. Yeah, that's part of it.
You support another round of rebate checks?
Yes.
Leader McConnell was so vague today when we
I
asked
I think they're
him
all
this.
Afraid of President Trump, and they're not living up to their responsibilities as senators or as American citizens, and it's really so sad that they don't, even in this instance, don't have the strength of character and conviction and belief in the American ideal to say something. They're just scared to death of this president. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.